And just like that, we're back here at the World Championship Series as it's time for another game, and it's pretty much another elimination game. It's time to decide who goes through in second place. Joining me on the desk this time, we have In Control and Rotterdam. Before we start talking about this upcoming match, what a series. We heard the boys' thoughts, but Roddy.
Yeah, I said it in the start of the day jokingly, you know, with Nate. I was like, this is the way that I want to start my day, you know, a PvP series. But now I'm really happy because that's just an awesome way to start a long day of StarCraft. It was so close, so hard to tell. And, you know, even when we just rewatched the final moments of that game and I was listening to the analysis that you guys did, I saw something that was even more cool. When Mana brought back his Oracle, he used the Oracle to kill a Colossus. Like, how often do you say that? The Oracle gets the final
shot. It was shooting the hallucinated Colossus.
No, it shot the real one. Yeah.
It didn't. We were breaking it down.
But he brought Stalkers and the Oracle back. Anyway,
the Stalkers did, yes.
It was just a great game. It was a really, really awesome game. The final moments, the micro battle, I loved it.
And every game like this is hopefully going to be on the edge of the seat, because every single player that's still left in this tournament knows how important each game is today, and hopefully we're going to continue where we started. So let's take a quick look at the bracket, as one last time we have one last game here in Group A before moving forward to Group B. Mana from Poland fighting to play for his country here and his nation this coming weekend goes up against Marine Lord, of course, representing the nation that is on fire right now, France.
The French oppressors. It's time to stand up to them. And, you know, I do think Mana's the underdog, but with what we saw, I mean, that was a hype match. He played really, really well. He came back with everything on the line.
Yep.
He's got the tools. He could do it.
And talking about momentum, man, when you win a game three like that, that close with your tournament life on the line,
Absolutely. That
is awesome. And you feel like you're on top of the world. You basically feel like you won this tournament already, you know, to bring it on.
Is that a little bit more difficult for Marine Lord? How do you look at it? I mean, we can look at Marine Lord and say that he's just been sitting there, saw what happened, knew exactly what happened, and now comes in kind of fresh.
And even though I'm sure that he doesn't really want to think like that, or maybe he wouldn't say it, if you're watching that game, you're Marine Lord, I think inside you're hoping Elfie wins, because you're looking at it, you're like, I think Elfie's going to be easier than Mana. And then you think he's going to win, and then he doesn't, like, yeah, I don't know.
Mana's a force to be reckoned with. I mean, we keep talking about this, but to be honest, it's a big point. He is playing in front of a small Polish audience here, but he's fighting for the right to play in front of a large one. He doesn't care about BlizzCon. That's not really a possibility for him. He wants to go to the round of eight to get more prestige, get a bigger prize check, and disrupt this guy right here. And talking about format, Marine Lord's been sitting here since a couple days now, just thinking about his last match, which was a loss. And of course, as a pro gamer, as good as he is, he's going to get rid of those thoughts and do what he can to get past it. But I like what Kevin's talking about too, man. Seeing Mana dig it out like that and clutch it up, I mean, it's got to be a little bit intimidating.
Yeah, it's such a good confidence boost for Mana coming into this cave. You already talked about it, but he sits now in front of Marine Lord, one single best of three away from getting where he needs to be.
And you know, the craziest thing is Mana has been on the verge of being eliminated like four times already this WCS season. It started off in Challenger, you know, a lot of people started watching WCS round of 16 or round of 8. In Challenger, this man was down 0-2 against Happy, one of the absolute best European Terran players, turned it around, and like I spoke with him back then on Battle, and I was like, holy man, that was amazing. And he was just responding to me in caps lock. He's like, oh my god, he's like, I thought I was so dead. He's like, after game two, my face was on my keyboard, I was just looking down, I was like, that's it, you know, it's done. But there's something magical about his run so far, and I definitely do think that he feels so good about it.
He's
right
an easy guy to cheer for. He's always been such one of the best personalities people of our community. It's great.
I mean, both of you have played competitive in the past. How difficult is it from both sides? I mean, you can look at it from Mana's side, knowing that how much is on the line, and Marine Lord coming into this. How difficult or maybe how easy is it to kind of rappel against all the nerves that are going to be kicking in? Obviously, there's so much there.
There are, and to be honest, this is the kind of tournament where we determine what kind of player they are. Something Todd talked about in the last discussion we had, he was talking about how these guys were microing and playing as well as they did with all that pressure on the line, and to me, that's the kind of stuff you look for. There's a lot of guys that can win in the comforts of their own home. They can come in here where there's low, you know, not necessarily here, but less pressure in round of 32, that kind of stuff. But now, elimination, facing a big guy, you're one best of three away from that big tournament. I mean, this is where we determine that.
All right, well, let's take a quick look at the map vetoes now. They have been determined between the two players. They've sat next to each other, they've chosen where they want to go, and it's going to be Terraform, Coda, and Cactus Valley, three maps that we have seen a lot over the last couple of days.
Yes, for sure. I think the last map, Cactus Valley, we've seen it as well. When Liu Bao played against 4GG, that can become a very, very difficult map for Protoss if it goes into three or even four bases. Like, three is often kind of doable, but trying to go for four bases, then Marines and Marauders just fly in from every angle. So that could become very tricky. First map, Terraform. That's an interesting one, because Terraform is like a map that most Protoss players look at like, I kind of like it, and I feel that Terran's not the biggest fan of it. And then Coda is kind of the map what everybody likes. Nobody really likes or dislikes Coda, but there's not too much to say about it, other than the fact that I think for mana, it would be very important to win the first two, and basically just close it out then.
Yeah, they do like it, but Coda actually has pretty skewed statistics in favor of Terran versus Protoss specifically on this map. And the numbers are taken from WCS exclusively, I believe.
Yes, they are. So we'll see how that that shapes up between the two. Let's have a quick look at Terraform then, before we jump into the series. The players are almost ready, but before that, Terraform. Do you think this favors any side, Roddy, in the games that you've played, or Jeff?
I kind of like it as Protoss, for the single fact that if you drop one pylon in your main base, which I'm sure Funka is going to point out as soon as we actually load it into the game, Reapers have a hard time making it into it. I also don't feel that this is a base where there's a whole lot of surface area for Medevacs. Like, often they can drop a couple units in the corner, but it's not like you don't see it coming. With often three observers on the map, you'll see pretty much everything. For instance, on Cactus Valley, you're going to need four or five if you want to see everything. So I kind of think this is okay for Protoss. It's okay to hide stuff. It's okay to take care of drops. It's very okay to go up to three bases. Like, you know, this is one of those maps where you really can't complain about the map layout if you play Protoss. So I kind of like this as a Protoss player. It's not super hugely favored in Protoss, but it's just a very straightforward map, which
is
often...
Well, it's 2-5, actually. They're underdog, if you will. And
they're underdog stats-wise.
A big part of that, stat-wise, is because I think I agree with Kevin in a lot of the points. The map is kind of congested, so force fields become kind of powerful. Not the biggest of deal in PvT, but early game it helps. But once you do take that third, defending top-down from your third, the classic third, the way into your main, there's a big kind of launch pad for Medivacs to come in there, and that's so common in a lot of these maps. And that's kind of the key point. Up until then, defending the natural, getting your third, like Kevin said... pretty easy. This map's not impossible to do that. Holding the third, defending the main from drops, that's where this map gets tricky.
Did you say that that's the most important part here for mana to defend against Marine Lord? And would you say, like, the flip side of things, that's where Marine Lord's going to be focusing, drilling in?
It could actually be a lot earlier, though, because Marine Lord can be very aggressive in this matchup. We've seen him play often in the past. It's often just Reaper into a Widowmine drop follow-up or Marines and Hellions, and Marine Lord is very good there. So if mana drops the ball one time, he's going to lose 10-plus probes, and then it's over already. So you need to survive that phase first, and then the phase that you were talking about.
Okay, we'll see if he can do that. But let's check in with the predictions. Of course, we've been following throughout the last couple of days, and the experts and commentators have thrown in their thoughts once again. 7-1 in favor of Marine Lord, and that one little guy who's chosen mana is on this desk.
Yeah, I don't know. I believe in the magical story so far. There is just something magical about it. He keeps being almost eliminated, and he keeps surviving. And Mana, there is one thing. He's been a tournament champion in the past. This guy has won pretty much the biggest StarCraft II tournaments out there in 2011, 2012. It's been a while, but he's always been around. He knows what it takes to play in these high-pressure scenarios. Well, Marine Lord is still kind of new to it. Before he had that great run in Season 2, Marine Lord didn't really have a whole lot to show for all the hype that he carries along. And I just feel in a clutch moment like this, and I think Mana can be very good in PvP, PvT, excuse me. He beat Happy. I just kind of think it's doable, but I'm not surprised that a lot of the guys think it's Marine Lord. I think it's going to be very close, but I just personally have a feeling that Mana's going to take it.
And you believe fully in the youngster, the Frenchman.
I think results-wise and in terms of where these players are at, he is the hotter player. He's got more to play for. Remember, he's that outside chance at BlizzCon, and he really needs to. I mean, well, he has to win here.
And he believes he can. He believes he can. Thank you very much, gentlemen. It's time to go to the commentary team for this one. It's going to be the old classical combo of Todd and Claris.
All right, the final match here for Group A to determine who is going to be moving on to the round of eight. We've already had Marine Lord there in our past season, and he's looking to repeat that success once again. But going up against Mana, we have already been able to see, as they mentioned over at the desk, that he has had some clutch moments so far in WCS.
Absolutely, and... Roddy, though, pointed out that after a game like this, you definitely have some momentum riding for yourself. And I really agree with that. Where, like, Mana right now, he must feel like he's on top of the world. And it's not over yet. He needs to win one more series.
Yes, he does. Against one of the most fearsome Terrans here in Europe at the moment. Up to the top left, we do have our blue Protoss representing Team Liquid. It is Mana. And down to the bottom right-hand corner. Interesting, interesting stuff. We do have our red Terran representing Team Millennium. It is Marine Lord.
Mana and Marine Lords, going into their Challenger match, they had to play the same matchup. Mana was going to face Happy and Marine Lord was going to face DMC. So they played about 50 games together. And when players play this many games together, they really get accustomed to playing against each other. And they really find out about each other's weaknesses. Apparently, it seems like Marine Lord has identified that one of the weaknesses of Mana is that he doesn't scout for proxies, maybe doesn't even scout at all upon starting a Nexus after a Gateway, which usually is the build that you go for here. So he's going to go for a Barracks being proxied inside the main of Mana here. And if Mana does not see this until very late, it's going to be very hard for him to defend properly. You need to see this as soon as possible.
Yeah.
Because when the first bunker finishes here, and then Marines start leaping from bunker to bunker, then it becomes so much harder to defend for Protoss. But Mana scouting this early is actually going to tell him decently early that something is up. He's actually going to check in his main. Oh my god.
Uh-oh.
Marine Lord's plan comes crashing down. He has to cancel the barracks immediately because he wasn't going to finish anyway. And Mana somehow figured out that this may be happening. He starts a second guess.
Forcing the cancellation there is very good for Mana here. This STV is just going to move on around and have a look, see what's going on, because behind all of this, he's got his barracks on the way. And Mana already knows that he is significantly forwards here in this game.
Yeah, this is a big, big deal here. We just saw Mana is going to get a nice lead here from this. Starting the second guess, he might be thinking that because the barracks of Marine Lord here was delayed so much, he can maybe just go into something like an Oracle and keep Marine Lord pinned on one base while he's going to expand himself. Or he might just try to, I guess, be aggressive here with something.
I mean, you said before the series started that, you know, Mana might be riding a high from that previous series, being able to keep himself alive. But now, after being able to thwart something like that in the start of this series, it's got to give him even more of a morale boost.
I mean, it's nice, but it's not like he scouts it and he's going to be really far ahead. If Marine Lord had committed, Mana would have won right out. But Marine Lord very quickly cancelled upon being scouted, and he's going to need not to get rattled here to try and keep up with some kind of plan B here. Which, by the look of things, he's just going to be the standard Reaper into a command center. So just going to go into standard play. Mana, on the other hand, though, 3+3 on the gases. Is it a Stargate here? Look, his pylon's ready on the top right-hand side. Yeah. I think he's going to be a Stargate here.
And also, he's got a pylon positioned to deny the Reaper from getting in on the right-hand side of his base here. It's one of the only locations you can really jump in there on that right-hand side wall. So Twilight Council's going to go down, though, for Mana.
Very interestingly, I guess he knew that he was going to have a Stalker and Mothership Core on time to keep that Reaper out ideally. So Mana, whether he goes Blink or Dark Templars here, it's supposedly not going to be revealed on time for Marine Lord to maybe, I guess, react properly.
I mean, that's the important thing about this Reaper, right? It's not just a usual, hey, I'll open up with a Reaper. Hey, maybe I'll harass some probes. It's specifically designed after the start of this game to get him information. It's trawling around the map. It's looking for anything that will be out of the ordinary. And at the moment, of course, it was denied at the front to get into the main.
Yeah, Mana, it looks like he wants to start a Nexus here. So not going to quite go into some kind of SOS or has one base blink play. In this case, should be seeing a bunch of gateways, though. At least, I would say at least two more, maybe three. He's actually going to put them in the corner here next to his Twilight Council as well to try and hide them. Were there to be a scan here used by Marine Lord to try and see what he's up against.
Right now, Marine Lord has not spotted that probe up towards the north, which will eventually try and sneak on away. The two Stalkers are going to find this Reaper and shoo it on off for now, but at least he keeps it alive. This does leave that probe in a bit of a susceptible spot, because
the Reaper,
it's a scary...
Oh my god, this is bad.
Yeah, that's not good.
Being able to see how far units go here on the map is a big tell of whether Protoss actually wants to be aggressive. Now the scan is completely going to miss here for Marine Lord. He's only saw the corner of a Robo, which is no good tell here for him to possibly realize what is going on.
Stalkers are on the way. Probe is up towards the north of these Stalkers as well, and even throwing down the pylon here. So light pressure on these three gateways, but it can still be very, very difficult for Marine Lord to deal with because he had a limited amount of production from the beginning. Everything was really slow. Damn, that's why he's gone for the three barracks opener. He wanted units out as quickly as possible after the deficit he was at.
Yeah, had a little bit of hesitation there. He started concussive shells, cancelled, and then started steam pack instead. Marine Lord, it looks like he knows that there's going to be something coming, so He kind of kept his orbital command in his natural, didn't saturate it, and he was ready to evacuate. But now he's moving out. This might be a big mistake.
Yeah, and with Blink finished here, he's
missed micro.
Yeah, he should have been able to keep these stalkers alive, every single one of them, and get a really, really good trade. One does fall, though, but he now knows that there's a pile on there, and his natural is going to be under threat with that bunker starting. He's got to make sure that that gets up and running. Focusing down the Marauder, that's the unit that's going to do big damage to these stalkers.
Another stalker dies here because he wasn't blinked on time. Mana, after some great micro last game, he's struggling here a little bit.
I really wants to just deny this bunker from being finished here. Marine Lord is desperately trying to push these stalkers back so he can get that up and running. Even pulling the SCVs off the line. Two buffer for those Marines, but it's still good focus fire.
Only Marines without steam here. It's going to be so hard for Marine Lord to make this work somehow without a bunker. He finally does get one. He's going to have to repair it, but he's lost so many SCVs and Marines here already.
Trying to bring down the bunker. Not too doable there with just that few stalker number he had. So warping in a few more here to continue on the pressure. But as we said before, this isn't some ridiculous all-in. He still has probes being made behind this, does Mana?
Yeah, Mana is not completely all-in anyway here with this. He's spending Chrono Boost on his probes, trying to build up his economy. He's still going to be trying to get in there to kill more and more SCVs, and he's going to be able to it quite easily as well. Robo Bear already going down here, by the way, against a Terran that only now starts a factory. There's going to be an opportunity for Mana if he wants to try maybe for something like a two base Colossus timing. He doesn't have to though, that'd be a big commitment and could be risky.
Forge going to come in as well here. Marine Lord's got a lot of ground to make up at this point. The Stalker's going to blink on back here again from this, trying to shoo away the SCVs from the bunker, otherwise we kill them. And then when they do go away, focusing on the bunker, didn't quite find his opportunity to kill it off though.
Yeah, and with a Robo Bear and a Forge on the way here, Mana is going to be able to get some upgrades started. Colossus as well blinks into the main here.
It's a lot of Marines.
There's Team Pack. This could be very dangerous here.
Oh, finds himself the Observer, but at the same time, will kill off a Marine or two. But the Observer's more valuable here. Being able to kill that off and deny the vision from the blink up once again is a good little step forward here for Marine Lord.
Marine Lord, he has identified here that Mana slowed down, so he's going to start a turret on his natural to make sure it doesn't die to some kind of DT follow-up. Especially on this map, you know, you got that one pylon that you can warp in straight into the natural with
that
third base, so you want to be careful here in this situation. Remember, this is a very important series and game here. And Mana from there, I wouldn't be surprised if he just went into a third base and tried to play it fairly normal, because he built up his economy here to a nice position. He's not actually ahead or anything, I feel, because it's 47 probes to 43 SCVs, and Marine Lord has double orbital, so sure, as much as all of the upgrades of Marine Lord, you know, combat shield, plus one, all that has been delayed, he's in an okay position. Marine Lord here can just drop down racks 4 and 5 very quickly, and then behind this, go into a third command center momentarily, and we're going to be heading into a regular game, I think, from
here. Does Marine Lord have to do any kind of special drop plays here to keep Mana back whilst he's playing like this, or is that going to be falling flat on its face here against Mana's position? How do you think that works out?
I don't think he has to commit too much to drops. He's been known to do that for a long time, but I feel like as of late, he's learned to slow down a lot more and not commit to big drops that will get killed and eventually lose him games in some of those counterattacks. But Marine Lord, one very important thing to note here is how Marine heavy he is. He's got so many Marines in comparison to Marauders. That's 28 Marines to two Marauders there. So against Colossus, the struggle is going to be real. But if he can circumvent wherever these Colossus are and drop elsewhere, attack elsewhere, do multi-pronged attacks, those Marines are going to come in very handy.
Third base is now on the way here for Marine Lord. Well, likewise, we have the third Nexus going down on the other side for Mana just a little bit before that third command center was started up. So Marine Lord's going to spot that. And despite everything that's gone on, he's kept up in workers. He's done well in his army supply. Here comes the drop now being loaded up. And this is where Marine Lord tries to find an angle when the Protoss are spreading themselves across these three bases.
Usually in Protoss versus Terran, as the Terran here, you want to try to hit the main and the third base at the same time. There is almost no point in hitting the natural because there is always going to be some units close enough to defend properly. So Marine Lord, it's really cool to see him drop outside of that third base here already to make sure. Oh, he wants to get a turret there.
Yeah, setting it up so that he could deny any observers from actually coming in or being able to spot in that location, leave him free reign to actually drop.
This
Good
is the first time I've seen this. I guess saving a mule and getting a turret there might be cheaper in the end.
Yeah. Oh yeah, I think he's done it a few times in his previous games, and it can work out, but the thing is he is playing it from a little bit far behind, so it's going to be interesting to see how it's going to work out.
Yeah, Marine Lord is building up his supply here very nicely, and he's taking it slow. I think he noticed here that Mana was ready to defend on every front, so there is no reason for Marine Lord to commit just yet.
There's an observer still over towards this location. It did spot the third base. Likewise, this drop trying to find an angle once again, but...
Where's the second starport, second eBay and armory? Nothing has started yet. Marine Lord is just pumping out 1-1 units here for a very, very long time. So I think he might just be committing here to aggression a lot. Kinda in a Maru-esque style where you need to do damage no matter what.
I know SCV pull stuff has gone out of fashion, but...
I think he's going to go for the massive Doom drop in the main and the attack at the third base at the same time.
Okay, well, we do have these three medevacs now loading up. He knows there isn't an observer there, but at the same time, Marine Lord...
Mana's ready.
So much.
Mana split is insane.
Yeah.
He's got two Colossi in the main. He's got enough on the third base to defend against this. I think the best alternative... Marine Lord's going to scan the main before getting there. I think Marine Lord right now, he saw that there was this much in the main. The best thing he can do is probably attack the third base with a lot of ground army and drop with the rest on top of Mana's army.
But
Mana right now, I feel like he's in a fantastic position. Already starting Storm, level 2 ground armor. He's going to start on whopping in High Templars before the Terran 2-2 even starts. This is massive.
Observer sees one of those medevacs on the very edge of vision here, so it's not actually even near that missile turret. Doesn't need to be as at the moment. This is difficult here for Marine Lord. He's kind of gone back to the insurance policy of, well, I threw down my second engineering bay, I threw down my armory, but hasn't even started the upgrades yet to complement them here.
Yeah, this is a bit weird here. He's going to start a second starport just now. Marine Lord, he wanted to do damage here. You could tell how much he wanted to try and do some damage or even... I guess commits a minimum to this aggression, but he has been shut down the entire time. So as much as it's nice that he kind of sat back and didn't throw away units in the end, the fact that he invested so much in this and wasn't able to do any damage just yet is going to put him in a really bad position, I think.
A probe, I think it may have seen a lot of those medevacs actually heading down there. It was very on the edge of vision, but those three High Templars are all important at the moment. Psystorm is about to finish in 8 seconds. That's going to do big AoE damage on this army if it moves forwards.
Both players right now, they're waiting for their opponent to do a mistake. Marine Lord's mistake here will be to attack, lose most of his army, get counterattacked, and die. Mana's mistake would be moving out, because if he moves out, then Marine Lord's just going to counterattack. Play the base trade, snipe all the nexuses, and be in a good position to get a win or even a draw at times. So
I mean, what is it that Marine Lord has to do here? Does he have to stall out the game for a little while?
He needs to do that for a very long time, and Mana, he can't really attack, because if he attacks, he gets counterattacked. So I think he just might be happy to kind of sit down himself, take more bases, leave High Templars everywhere, start getting a bunch of cannons as well, maybe. The thing is, if Marine Lord gets a whole bunch of ghosts, he's going to be okay, maybe, going down the line to just build up a massive army of ghosts and Vikings as well to deal with these Colossi and High Templars.
Yeah, we see that being the usual go-to composition. These Marauders holding their own against these Zealots in this small choke point. Eventually, they'll be able to kill those off. Likewise,
oh, there's not much on the third base. This is what I was talking about. As soon as the Protoss moves out, Marine Lord gets in there. He's going to be looking to snipe the Nexus here.
He abandoned it. He abandoned his post. And that is going to die off. There's no way he's going to be able to deal with that at all. Just leaving a few units behind there to get the full kill on it after the retreat comes out. And, well, Marine Lord picks up a good Nexus snipe.
Yeah, that's a costly one here, though. Definitely lost a lot of units, but I guess he can replace them with ghosts in the end. So I don't think Marine Lord will care too much. He's still looking to expand here with more command centers on the way. And he's going to be ahead on upgrades here in a second with 2-2 against just 2-1. And personal cloaking having started immediately, he's even going to have that to work with. There is not that many observers on the field. There's only two.
Marine Lord heads down towards the bottom left, and getting this denial would be very, very nice as well here. Dark Shrine starts up for Mana, but forcing the cancellation down towards the bottom. Good stuff here for Marine Lord.
This was a big snipe here for Marine Lord, really pinning Mana on two bases, now having to restart a third Nexus. For a second, it looked like he was going to be able to get up to four bases. Oh my god, the two armies.
Ooh.
These are not the two passing ship in the night.
No, they've completely found sight of one another, and cannons are going to fly as we get after a lot of feedbacks going down onto the medevacs, actually. Not that many medevacs left alone, so any stim here is really going to hurt this Bioforce, but the blink forwards was very, very far forwards, and he did lose a few of those Stalkers.
And Mothership Core was sniped as well. Cloaking
he
here is going to be used. He's chasing him.
He doesn't have an observer.
There is only two observers on the map.
Oh,
and they're
sniping the High Templars, picking them off.
Elsewhere.
Really, really good move there. Coming in with the Vikings as well. Has to throw down retreating force fields out here to be able to save a lot of his army. Storm goes down, trying to kill off some of these Vikings. But Marine Lord is really, really gung-ho with this.
Yeah, he's sacking some of his Vikings here to make sure he gets at least one more Colossus. And now Mana is going to be back up to three bases as we started day fourth. But High Templars are dying. This was a disaster here for Mana. He lost so many Colossi, High Templars as well. Preserves his Grand Army, but again, the gateway units are like the least important part of his army there. And behind this, Marine Lord's going to be happy to keep on massing more of those ghosts. He's actually got a bunch of units on that third base that he took earlier and misrallied here from one of his barracks.
Yeah, that's two ghosts. That's quite a lot of expenditure there. But for now, he needs himself a few more medevacs out with this army for sure. He cannot continue to keep stimming with it. Three are about to pop out here. He's still got his Viking count nice and high. Maybe wants to repair a few of those to go into this fight once again. But there's not really any storms here with this army. It's only the Colossi. The High Templars are going to come in from the back
here.
Why
is Mana being so aggressive? He's not even maxed out. He's got so many minerals and he's going to be losing some very important Colossus even though he's... Storms on top of the Vikings there.
There's only one Colossus left alive here. Not that much AoE damage at all. He catches himself some of the ghosts thanks to the fact that he has an Observer with the army now. But the upgrades are on the way here for Marine Lord.
Yeah, Marine Lord, this is just great here for him. He starts his plus 3 attack upgrade, so did Mana. Second Robo is going to go down. I can't believe Mana is only on one Forge here, by the way. Looks like he wanted to stay on one single Forge the entire game. Definitely at the economy for some time to go for another one.
Finds a good little angle here to be able to pick off an SCV or two. Not too bad. Very annoying for a Terran to deal with that. You don't have something like Blink. You can't really jump over there too easily.
Marine Lord having double starports with two reactors helps so much in building up this Viking count very nicely against just one Robo up until now.
Here comes the army once again, though. It's very, very small. The High Templar's going to try and flank and do something to this Bio, but that Bio Force still remains quite strong. That one Colossus at the back is doing a lot. Doesn't see the warp into the left-hand side. Storms are going to hit that again. Marine Lord's going to have to back on off.
Yeah, this was a little bit premature here for a fight for him to take all of these units. They are very, very low. Mana, is he going to chase here, even though there is a Planetary Fortress to try and trade?
He's got to be careful about an EMP on towards that army alone.
I'm really surprised that Marine Lord moved out just now, because you're supposed to mass ghosts, wait for them to have full energy, and then you go for the attack. Try to deny all the storms and feedbacks that you can.
Planetary Fortress helping out in that defensive posture as well. Not exactly the easiest spot there for Mana to push into. Look at the army supply. 61 against 98 right now. Marine Lord's macro has been really on point. Look how much... He has so little minerals, even though he's mining across the extra bases up towards the top.
Mana tried to fly his War Prism, I think, into the main, but there were turrets there ready to receive him. And now is the time for Marine Lord to start doing some of these drops if he thinks that there is not enough army in position.
That's a great point. I mean, the entire army of Mana is down towards the south here.
But there's in control cannons in the main, and we know how deadly these are.
He doesn't have a mothership core either, so he can't recall back to these locations to try and help it on out. We'll be able to drop in here, kind of crossing the T of two of these cannons. They'll go down very fast, and sorry, they really didn't do that much.
Storm is just going to feedback, get an Archon here as well. Dark Templar was warped in to try and defend in the main here.
Well, that cannon actually cut off the retreat path of some of these units, but enough die off so that there is only one medevac's worth of units to get out.
Both flares, they actually have a very similar worker count here. And Mana is now taking the gold base. Marine Lord here, all he has to do is wait until he has a good amount of Vikings to deal with the Colossus and enough ghosts to make sure he can EMP the entire Protoss army over and over. And then he's going to go for the fight. And it's going to be so hard for Mana to pull it off. What he's doing right now is very risky, actually, against Vikings, but Marine Lord a little bit slow to react properly to this.
The medivac. Vikings.
Rip.
Really needs more Vikings right now. You're totally right about that. Five Colossi against six. Not exactly the best of numbers here for Marine Lord. A few just popped out now, though. But looking at the stage of this game, you wouldn't have expected it to have started out with a Proxy Oracle in-base had to be cancelled. Both of them, especially Marine Lord, playing this out after that kind of setback very, very well.
Ooh, if he goes through this, your Marine Lord, this could be dangerous, but... He's got item plus and Colossus against not that many Vikings and ghosts. The ghosts are trapped behind.
Still a huge army. Good storm will land on some of that bio towards the left-hand side here, but still the ghosts remain. Another storm lands down here. Marine Lord's going to be able to power on through this, though. It's such a strong bio army with those Vikings in tow, and Mana is going to have to retreat fully out.
This was way too early an attack here for Mana, who wasn't even maxed out. He lost so many important Colossus. And behind this, he's down to one single Colossus against nine Vikings. This might be a good time here for Marine Lord to try and go and snipe one of these bases, because even though there's going to be a lot on the ground, it's just going to be gateway units. He can kite and listen. Gets another Colossus here at the gold base.
Very, very nice. The Marine Lord's not even done. If this army doesn't kill him at the front, he's got three Ghost Academies going down at the back here. With the movement forwards, trying to kill off this. Good storms again from the flanking High Templars. Stalkers were even doing damage at the back.
The Vikings are not doing anything, sadly, for him. If he had landed those and just kited endlessly, he would have been able to maybe do even more damage there.
They might
Mana
damage.
Has so much minerals. Oh, my God.
It was Zealots underneath them.
What's going on with Mana's bank here? He's been missing a lot of those warping cycles. And that ghost, by the way, is in enemy territories. Oh, he gets the snipe! He gets one and almost another one here before the ghost finally dies.
spend all your energy and try and kill off what you can when there's no observer above you, and that triggers mana now to
oh
get an observer.
Oh my gods.
It's nuke time. It is nuke time. Four nukes. As Funker tries to click on it, and more things just appear on the production tab. And they are on their way. So
right now, Happy is watching this game, and he's like, I always knew.
It was always going to devolve into this all-out nuclear warfare here from Marine Lord.
And this is very smart, because this late into a game like this, you don't want to be the one engaging into your opponent, because as Protoss, you engage into Ghost, EMP, Sniped, and as Terran, you engage into Storm, Colossus, set up in Concave. So whoever engages into the opponent is going to be at disadvantage a lot of the time. Whereas now, Marine Lord, by doing this, is going to force, I think, mana to engage into him. And especially these positions where there is a lot of cannons, it's going to be very important for him to try and nuke these in particular.
This poor ghost. From the shrubs, he has been attacked.
I see the observer.
Oh.
Too late.
Does the observer have observer speed? It does, doesn't it? By the looks of things.
No, it doesn't.
Yep. He's got himself that little boost on. So that's a nice upgrade to actually have here from the observer to be able to just kind of keep himself way more defended in these locations.
Yeah, right now Marine Lord is going to be sending another one of these in. I think mana's hit point. Like, if the first one gets revealed this easily, it's really easy behind this to anticipate the next ones. But he hasn't made that many cannons in places that he might not be able to react to this properly. Let's see if Marine Lord can somehow hide this properly here.
Where is he going? All the way. Deciding which base he's going to nuke. Does drop the first one, so that is going to try and go towards the gold base.
Mana is trying to look everywhere for red dots. He's not finding it right now.
And it's on towards his gold base. Tries to evacuate out just before.
Close. I don't think he saw it. I think he heard it being close to this direction and gets out here.
Another nuke got launched, I think, right? And a second one on towards the gold base, and it's just going to keep raining down. And he finds it once again here, the red dot.
Oh, observers find the ghost and are going to be chasing it.
That's a
both
lot of
players
ghosts.
Are maxed out. Marine Lord's going to try to use this opportunity here to go good, for a fight.
Good feedback, but at the same time, the entire army gets blanketed there by EMPs. This is a lot of Bioforce, but the flank here from Mana.
Oh, there's some High Templars.
Those High Templars, if they're able to connect with Storms, that'll be a good little pushback from him here. He tries to kill off quite a few of the Bioforce at the front there with it, but doesn't have that much AoE damage left. This is going to kite for a long time here is for Marine Lord.
Yeah, Mana definitely made a big, big save here by evacuating on time. And behind is the fight that took place, leaves him with a little bit more supply and still quite a big bank. If Mana keeps on reinforcing here with charge loss, he might be able to try and...
His Vikings! They were above a lot of those, and he doesn't actually have the vision here on the ghosts. As they're just going to go completely to town on this. It's a storm preempt, yeah. Like, just to try and catch them.
He's not doing damage on that mineral line here at this one base. Four Marine Lords. Gonna have to pull back for a moment. I'm surprised that he didn't drop down some additional gateways, but in the end, he was able to do well enough in the fight that right now I don't think he's that threatened against this small army here of Marine Lords.
Everything's so close between them. The supplies, the work count is exactly the same here at the moment.
I honestly think that Mana is pretty nervous right now because, like, this kind of bank, you're never supposed to have this. You make enough gateways usually to spend that very, very quickly. And right now, Mana just gonna boost it out. All of his, I think it's 13 gateways that he's got, and he's still struggling to spend everything. He's got so many minerals.
Gonna head into first person view of Mana now, who has been multitasking quite well for himself. Scan would already drop on that though, with these stalkers trying to harass, and he gets himself the sensor tower there, sending some zealots in towards that third base as well, and warping in even more, taking the base up towards the north and setting himself up more defensive positions wherever he can.
Yeah, Mana's trying to catch a chunk of the army here of Marine Lords.
It's very tense though. I mean, you need to keep babysitting your main army while trying to find harassment opportunities anywhere. Still warping in more units up towards the top. Checking a lot of these bases as well. I think he just heard a nuke being called down. Unless I didn't. I can't quite recall. Okay, so there is definitely a nuke being called down. Oh yeah, it was over towards his third base.
But here we go, maybe with the engagement, these ghosts don't have that much energy there. The mana mule might be a little bit early here.
Yeah, maybe.
You need to wait until you won the fight, mate.
Yeah, and even mining this goal base from the backside, knowing that it will be a little less vulnerable to the army's location currently. Very cool stuff. Zealot's going to be sent around, though. They will be shut down. Sorry, mule.
I'm a little bit surprised that neither of them tries to hit towards the north, where... the current base that we're just taking have the most minerals, but I think they're both really focused right now on trying to win the fight right there. And Mana's army is so scary, oh my god. And he's not even maxed out. He's still got supply here. He's still got room to make even more than that.
9 High Templars. As long as he has some... Actually, he got some the High Templars down towards the bottom here with another ghost that found it. He was looking for the flank opportunity from the shrubbery. And we'll be able to kill off a few.
This has been a crazy game here.
Yeah, really, really fantastic game to start things off in this best of three. And again, they're both their tournament lives on the line here. Mana, Marine Lord wants to get the repeat. Mana wants to be on that stage in Krakow later on as we have a huge engagement going down. Those Archons leading the charge along with the Zealots as well. Going to tank up quite a lot. And actually, Marine Lord just backing off out here.
It's going to be so hard for him to get out. There's not enough ghosts here. They're out of mana as well.
Oh, another great storm from a flanking High Templar here from Mana. He's really doing the business in the later stages of this game. Up in army supply at the moment. Doesn't want to go through that choke point, though, with that spread from Marine Lord.
Oh, this is crazy here. These guys, you can tell they're giving it their everything here right now. And Mana, with the amount of High Templars that he has here right now, he must be very, very comfortable, I think, in this game with 8 High Templars around the map. Cannons protecting them as well from ghosts and everything. It's interesting, by the way, that Mana took that 12 o'clock base before the one on the right-hand side of his main. Why would you do that?
Yeah, that is
I'm going to mine the other side of the map before anything else.
I guess he was scared of some shots coming from the back of the mineral line, I suppose, if some units were to be sent there. But one thing's for sure is that he didn't really anticipate this base being taken. He wanted to take it himself, but...
Yeah, that one Dark Templar is going to be very annoying here. Oh, actually, almost... Can I get a ghost? Oh, he clocks on time!
Okay, good stuff. EMP.
Oh, my God.
Ghost versus High Templar. Rare, you actually get to see that. He EMP'd the Dark Templar, but hit himself as well.
And the probes. Two players here trying. Oh, my God. Whoever attacks here into the other is, again, going to have a really hard time winning the fight properly.
This game's all over the place. This is pretty ridiculous.
And Marino's kind of is getting broke here right now, especially gas wise. He's not doing well.
How is the army here, of all places? It could get stuck. I think he has to retreat out from this location.
Yeah, I think Marine Lord is... He kind of wants to try and catch this army, crush it, and then maybe try and move across the map to end it.
High Templar's going to get themselves a few storms off against just a few of those units at the front, but at the same time, Zealots got split off. They splintered off from that main force to try and cause some disruption while the rest of the army gets out. Very good move here by Mana, considering his mineral bank.
Marine Lord is missing a few very important upgrades, by the way. He doesn't have level 2... armor upgrade for his bio. These High Templars!
Just any damage you can do, I suppose, with storms. If he's able to actually come in here from the right-hand side as well, trying to do some damage towards this. EMP hit in the middle of that force, though, here. How much is the bio going to be able to do against this? There's not that many Zealots to actually buffer for these this ground army at all, though. The Colossus are going to end up dying off. This is so close in terms of the army supply. He needs to warp in a big chunk of units here to reinforce. More Zealots are going to come in. Storm's going to drop down from the north here. I'm morphing in an Archon, and... there's not that much bio left over because he just doesn't have the money to be able to replenish the bio.
Yeah, Marine Lord is completely broke. All he's getting right now is Marines, more and more Marines. He's trying to hold down here against this army of Mana who didn't even need to commit, actually, because he had so many minerals.
Just kiting on back, kiting on back. Zealot's going to come in again, trying to get a good old bio sandwich, but alas, that's not to happen. Marine Lord is going to babysit these units with ferocity because he knows that the majority of all he's got left, he doesn't have anything left in the taps.
Oh my god, Marine Lord somehow chases this army here, but now Mana with enough Stalkers to chase these down. It's going to be in a much better position, especially those two Colossi here that came out against the now only two Vikings of Marine Lord.
I've watched a lot of games with Funker observing, and never have I seen some of his observing being more frantic. Just cheering how some of these engagements have played on out here in this first game. Really impressive stuff. Even cannons towards the front to protect this pylon that he can warp in from. He has to evacuate out. This is desperate times here for Marine Lord.
Yeah, that one single medivac in the main against 1,500 minerals Protoss on... quite a few gateways. Not necessarily going to do a lot here, I think.
Just trying to kill off the pylons here, deny the warp-ins from continuing on. He sees the warp-in coming down now and now. It's going to be a little bit scary to deal with all of those Zealots. There you go, GG. Mana takes game number one. And wow, what a game number one we just saw. So far, for me, that's the best round of 16 game of the entire show.
Mana really showed us that in a longer game like this, with a lot of bases, a lot of High Templars and Colossus, he's definitely more comfortable than a Marine Lord who struggled in getting out and of Ghost, I think, to deal with this army and even in the control at times.
Yeah, very, very well done there by Mana, especially considering how everything started at the beginning there for Marine Lord. Obviously taking a bit of a risk But he was able to keep himself in it regardless. But now, though, we are going to go to a short break. And when we are back, it will be game number two here between Mana and Marine Lord. Welcome back to the World Championship Series here for StarCraft 2 as we get into game number 2 between Mana and Marine Lord. And at the moment, after what we saw there from Mana in our first game in this series, if he's able to make just one more game happen, he will be moving on to the round of 8 to play in Krakow in front of that full Polish audience. That's going to be fantastic.
One of the few times I actually wouldn't be disappointed at all about being wrong with the prediction, KLIs.
All right, well, let's get into it. It will be game number 2 here now. Marine Lord is looking to keep himself alive in this World Championship Series. It's one map between him and Elimination here. There are a lot of French hopes riding on his back, on his shoulders. So we have Spawn down at the bottom right-hand corner. It is our blue Protoss representing Team Liquid. It is Mana. And up to the top left-hand corner, our red Terran. Representing Millennium, it is Marine Lord.
Marine Lord, I think it's not just the initial proxy that he wanted to go for that put him in trouble. It's also the fact that, again, he masked on bio, he masked on medivacs. He wanted to do some damage, but Mana's defense was impeccable.
Yes.
The entire game. And from there, if you neglect your tech, if you neglect any kind of Vikings that you want to add onto your army to deal with the Colossus, and in particular the Ghosts, I think were a big deal. He never reached a very high Ghost count, which is what you want against this kind of big Protoss ball. In the end, I really think that this is what cost him the game. And if he wants to win next time in this situation, if he somehow finds himself in this situation again, he's going to have to execute this a lot better.
Yeah, he is. It's a little bit of a sad tale there for Marine Lord in the end, considering how much of a fight he was able to put up, but that's just how it goes. Mana played out a blinder of a game, something that Mana, you know, sometimes there's little shaky performances from here or there, but that was a fantastic setup there from him. Always keeping the Terran on his toes in the middle of the map and always trying to find flanks in those engagements, which can be utterly terrifying for a Terran to deal with.
I think a lot of people as well, in this going to this group, they probably anticipated this to be the winner's match with one of them advancing on to the next round already. Mm. But that was without counting too much on Zenster, who definitely ruined their plans here.
Yes.
And took first place in this group earlier.
Yeah, we should definitely not forget about our winners today of the groups. Of course, all of these players today are going to be fighting for second place in their groups, whilst we had some just fantastic performances and upsets throughout our past 2 days, which I'm sure you can catch up on in terms of results.
You can tell how much these guys have played against each other and have studied each other, because Mana scouting this much, you don't have to do this against someone that you know will not necessarily always be playing super aggressive. And I'm guessing he's going to have to let that Zealot finish here to make sure that he can kill that Ibe comfortably. Here will Mana.
Yep, never really want this to happen. Normally, if you're a little bit newer to StarCraft, sometimes
you see... Look at the Reaper, actually, sorry, but the Reaper came back here because I think Marine Lord knows that there's a Proban on the map. And he went right by her.
Yeah, well,
it's going to be able to confirm actually here that there is still gas being mined, which is a very important info, because it means that there's going to be a factory behind this. Unless Marine Lord has a bomber moment,
yeah,
and he stops mining the gas and starts the third command setup, but nope, just going to be the usual factory there.
Mothership Core going to move out towards there to get kind of confirmation of what's been seen and towards the main, or at least try and get some more information alone. Reaper just going to jump on in towards the back. And there is that little wall that he's created at the back there, so the Reaper can't quite easily loop around, but that's already been spotted. Maybe do a little bit of damage here and there.
Oh, he might lose one probe here. Stalker had to be counter-boosted once, by the way. Marine Lord has created a lot of discomfort here for Mana already, having to pull probes from his gas. The scout on the other side. The Mothership Core is going to be able to confirm that there is indeed that one factory that started. Mana wanted to make sure. And now, since he hasn't started any kind of tech just yet, he can still go for a Twilight, but we should be seeing some kind of detection no matter what, which is usually a robo. But nope, since he's the target, Mana might just be going into maybe some Phoenixes, maybe an Oracle before. Both of these will help a lot, clearly, in killing those Widowmines that you know are going to be coming no matter what, because not too many people do get Hellions. And usually not with these builds.
Phoenixes is something that's a little more uncommon, but Mana's definitely a person we've seen in the past mix it in. We've seen him use it against people like Marine in Challenger Series here in the World Championship Series.
You mean Hero Marine?
Hero Marine. Marine.
His opponent right now is named Marine Lord, so...
Oh, okay.
Everyone that has Marine in their name, start calling them Marine.
Yeah, if you want to make that distinction, I can see why that is. Normally, you kind of rag on me because he doesn't like being called it, but he doesn't mind. Then, with Marine Lord playing here, I should call him Hero Marine. But anyway, regardless,
it's like, what do you do if Hero Marine plays against Marine Lord? Call them Hero and Lord?
I just give up and leave the caster's desk. For now, we'll actually kill off this Reaper at least towards the back and move on towards the front, where he's going to throw down his Robe of Silty, and it will be Phoenix Opener. It's a really cool little tactic to use against Terrence to try and even just find medevacs wherever you need to.
Yeah, you need to be careful. Even with Phoenixes, if you're out of position just for 1 second, if Widowmines can land and be burrowed into mineral lines, that's going to mean trouble. In this case, though, it looks like Marine Lord definitely wanted to slow down in terms of being aggressive and got a Viking first here, if anything. Just kept his Widowmines back at home defensively there.
Phoenix flies in, and you can tell if this is a hallucinated Phoenix or not from on Marine Lord's side is how much damage it's taken. If it was a hallucinated Phoenix, it would be taking double the damage from those volleys. So Marine Lord should be able to read into that and know what he's playing against in terms of a little bit of a composition.
Excellent adjustment, I think, from Marine Lord of being able to realize that this aggression wasn't going to do anything in the end if you had gone for a medivac and Widowmine drop. So he just kind of sat at home, burrowed these Widowmines there, and waited until, I guess, the Protoss possibly flew in there to try and kill whatever was being flown in there, which in this case, Mana was able to avoid.
And it's just spread itself out with a few units here and there, just in case there were to be any slight drops coming in.
That's a lot of Phoenixes, by the way. Four? Definitely could have stopped at two, but I guess he was like, that. Well, I'm already at two. If I go up to four, then I can at least defend better against Medivac drops. Now, the question is going to remain. Is it going to be a Colossus Phoenix heavy style, or is mana going to cut very soon here? And we got a fifth one here starting.
Yeah, he really likes it. We've seen it before in those games, as we were mentioning, and it can help buffer against Viking numbers if you're committing a lot to Colossi in those later engagements. So it can be a tricky little composition to deal with for a Terran.
Yeah, racks 4 and 5 is now on the way here for Marine Lords. Soon gonna have the economy to start a third command center very comfortably. And 4 more gateways went down here for mana, so he's gonna go up to 5 in total. The main gets scanned, I don't think. Yeah, there was not much here to be spotted.
Yeah. Oh well. And he's even killed off another Marine over towards the left hand side here with the Phoenix. I wonder if he's been able to hide the majority of the Phoenix numbers though. It's something, again, that Terrans don't really have to deal with too often. That's a lot more extra gateways going down here. But that Bioforce moving out towards the middle of the map, at least he has his first Colossus to be able to greet it.
Mana's on 48 probes. Does he want to go for something like a timing here, or...? Because he's going up to a lot of gateways. That's 7 in total. Already invested into Phoenixes. He might be hoping to crush Marine Lord's army if Marine Lord was to attack, and then go for the counterattack. We've seen this more and more in Prologue versus Terran recently.
The Phoenix are lingering on the edge of this battle. That's not the edge, that's too far forward. One Phoenix is going to go down.
And there is no Forge, by the way, for mana here. I think, hey, this might be a two base here. He's not getting probes anymore. As I say that, he sends the probe to the third, of course.
Damn.
But not having any Forge.
Oh, it's not going to the third. He throws a pylon down in the middle and he is going to start walking across.
Wow, mana.
Uh-oh.
Possibly putting in all on the line here with the two base timing. Needs to be careful though, this army of Marine Lord is still pretty scary.
Very uncommon we actually see this kind of play coming along.
I think Marine Lord read into it, to be honest. He saw that there was Phoenixes, he saw that there was Colossus production starting. Instead of going for a very quick third command center, he started a second starport very quickly on the reactor.
But is it
so the more
already?
He waits now, the better it's going to get for him, but mana has no plan to sit back. He's just going to start moving across the map. And Marine Lord's going to be doom dropping in a second.
Yeah, that's 4 medevacs worth against this army that's completely in the middle of nowhere. Marine Lord now is looking to do big, big damage against this completely exposed main base going towards the Nexus. Mana has no choice but to actually go for this. I don't think he does have a mothership core. Where on earth is it? I mean, he's already lost the main base Nexus.
He's surrounded natural. Marine Lord's fighting a little bit too early here against this, but in terms of base trade, he's just in a great position here. He's already took down the first Nexus very quickly. He's going to be able to start flying away with his orbital commands. Like, it feels like at worst here, Marine Lord maybe gets a draw, unless he's held back at home.
Yeah, Photon Overcharge was there. Colossus just popped out. The Colossi on the other side of the map.
Oh my god, mana is on top
alive.
Of the production now, and these SCVs are doing absolutely nothing to help.
Yeah, he can't do anything with this. Any Vikings that he had before have been killed off by the Phoenix, and this army is just running away. The Widowmines can't do anything in the main base, and they're being zoned out. The Colossi go completely uncontested.
I think mana had anticipated that this was going to happen, so he left the Mothership Core back at home and was able here to deal with this army, and in the end, not losing his Nexus back at home is going to mean the world to him, because Marine Lord is down to his last few forces. 33 army supply to 71.
This is mana putting it all on the line with this push, and when he is able to accomplish this with this army, he's going to be able to move on to Krakow. This is amazing here from him. He chases the Vikings off once again here with the Phoenix. The natural is all that is really remaining here for Marine Lord, but he has no army at all. He has 20 army supply against 61. The SCVs are going to come off the line here. Marine Lord is trying to have some last stand, some last hope against this, but mana kills off the SCVs. The remaining ones come off. GG! And mana is not only able to make the top 8, but in his home country here. What a result here for Liquid Mana.
Marine Lord here with a lot of the correct reactions to what mana was doing, but in the end, mana just brilliant reactions to everything himself. It seems like he was just one step ahead the entire series. Not just the scouting of that proxy, but even behind his, all of the decisions. In that game here, it's so easy to mess up in this situation here as mana. Bring your Mothership Core across the map to hope that the Terran's going to be there so you can crush his army with a Time Warp. But in the end, leaving that back at home and defending against the army of Marine Lord, it put him in a great position.
They are playing very, very close to us. And the first thing Mana does, walks over and hugs his girlfriend because that's how much it means to him here. Let's go to Mana, who is on the desk with the boys.
Thank you very much, Kolaris. Joined here by Mana.
since you heard about the WCS coming to Poland from the very beginning and coming to the round of 32, you saw how much it meant to you in the round of 32, and you've done it. You've got your goal. You're going to play in the main event. This is a big moment for you. You said in the interviews we did in the round of 32, it's one of the most crucial moments in your career.
Yeah, I've been practicing a lot. And even though I lost versus Answer, I did everything I planned to do, and it worked out just as I planned to do. And even though I lost. So I was a little bit confused after that series, but I went to Snoot. We analyzed together our my mistakes and so on. And I tried to keep calm because I was doing fine. It was just, you know, one slip up in a series, and I tried to keep calm in my series versus Elfie, which is very hard as well, and versus Marine Lord. So I'm very happy now.
Everyone, all of us, the casters, everyone said against Elfie, you just looked levels and levels above of what we saw you the other day. You played so very, very well. What was it that gave you the edge coming into today? What gave you that boost, and what was able to keep you playing at that type of level?
I think just knowing the game a little bit better, the meta that I can abuse. But Elfie played much better than I expected him to do. I saw him playing a lot of the games yesterday and today as well, so I was getting a little bit worried, so I tried to catch up to him, and I was playing a lot as well. So we both, I think, played at our highest level, so I think it was a cool series to watch.
So you made it. You're going to Krakow. You're going to play in front of the Polish crowd. They've all been cheering for you here in the studios and, of course, back at home as well. I mean, it means a lot to you.
Yeah, I'm really happy for that. And I really hope the Polish crowd will not disappoint. I'll play, they will cheer, and this will be fine.
Jeff?
Well, even just getting into the game a little bit in that last one, what did you see to make you want to do the two base timing attack? I mean, with the Phoenix, it's not super common, but you must have seen something or felt something.
When I scouted with the one Phoenix, I saw he didn't go for like Widowmine drops and so on because he tried to transition after he scouted my one Phoenix, so it would get shut down. And I saw the Tech Lab was not researching Steam, so it would be very, very late. And also his army, the Tech Labs, not a lot of Marauders would be there. So yeah, I went for it because I also kept on denying his scouting of my third. I think it was the right decision to do.
Absolutely. Well, yeah.
I guess.
So expectations going into the quarterfinals. Obviously, we've got some fantastic players here in the Premier League. Is a round of eight is just, that's it. I'm very, very pleased with this result. Or can you, like, obviously, I think you'd like to go to the round of four. What do you think you can do?
I can go to round of four. Of course, it depends what kind of opponent I get, but I am capable of competing with any of the left competitors. Yeah. I'm not saying I'm going to be a favorite against Polter or Hyder or something like that, but I can do my best and prepare some stuff for that. Round of eight is something that I wanted to achieve since WCS because I always ended up in round of 16 or round of 32 or even less. So that was kind of a good goal for me to go. Now, once I'm here, I want to see how far I can go, but there's no pressure on myself. I'm not putting any pressure on myself, and I will do my best anyway.
You're going to be going up against either Polt or 4GG. First place finishes from Group C and D. You cannot go up against a first place player from Group A or B. What do you think about that?
Well, that's a surprise now. I don't know. I don't want to spoil anything. I think I said everything in the previous question.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much, Amanda. Congratulations on going through in second place here from Group A. Let's take a quick look at the bracket as we get ready to move through to the next part of the day, which is going into Group B. Zanster is in first place that qualified the other day, and Mana today in second place. And a massive result, not just for Mana, but for Poland as well. Obviously, hoping and praying to have a player represent them in the playoffs, and they've got what they wanted in control.
I've put this out there pretty well, so I feel like it's established. But I'm a big underdog fan. Even myself, I thought Marine Lord was the favorite, and this guy's playing from his live audience. He's got his significant other here. Like, it's a really cool story, and I really like hearing and seeing someone say, yeah, I worked, I analyzed it with my teammate, by the way, which is something that we always talk about in StarCraft, but it doesn't necessarily always happen. Usually when you lose, the last thing you do is go, hey, Kevin, tell me everything I did wrong. Let's work on that. But that is good. You should do that. But to be honest, a lot of people don't. That's why pro gamer houses have a leg up.
And he definitely did that, and it seemed to give him some edge today. But Roddy, you watched that series, you followed Mana's game one, you casted game one, you watched that one. Yeah. A wonderful display from him today.
No, absolutely. I mean, game number one was one of the most ridiculous games we've seen in a while. 40 minutes of almost non-stop fighting. It wasn't a flawless game. You know, we're looking at it, and he has so much mana. He has so much money. He had so much money all the time. We're like, it could be better, but at the same time, it still felt he was always in control of it, despite a couple of unfavorable favorable engagements. He always had a plan to fall back on, and it's been a magnificent run so far, man. Like I said this before, but WCS doesn't start here. It's not these two series. It started like more than a month ago, where he was down 0-2 in Challenger. He was 1 inch away from not even playing in the round of 32, from not even playing in the round of 16, and now he makes it to the round of 8. Like, that's a unique story on its own already.
Yeah, an absolutely fantastic performance from Manon. We're going to see this weekend if he can continue to perform as well as he did today. But that's it wrapped up for group number A, or group number one. Group A, it's time to get ready for group B and go into our next matches. We're going to be Kung Fu Panda versus Sen.